Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Cinematic Excrement. Before we begin today's episode, I feel obligated to warn you that the footage you are about to see contains images that have been known to cause seizures in certain people, and viewer discretion is advised. It's not that it contains any rapidly flashing colors or anything like that, it's just that it's so stupid your brain may turn itself off as a defense mechanism. It happened to me. Well, I guess it's time to watch the Oogieloves and the Big Balloon Adventure. But it's just a crappy kids movie. How bad can it be? Oh yes, it is that bad. Not only was Oogieloves panned by the critics and nominated for a Worst Picture Razzie last year, as well as Worst Screen Ensemble, it has also earned its place as one of the biggest box office bombs in history. Upon its release, it broke the record previously held by 2008's Delgo for the worst opening weekend of any very wide release, which translates to about two people per showing. It made just over $1 million during its theatrical run, a paltry fraction of its $20 million budget. So where exactly did this movie go wrong? Or would a better question be, where did it go right? Let's take a look. The movie opens with an introduction to the faces that will undoubtedly haunt your nightmares for the next few days.
Welcome to our movie. I'm Gooby, and I like scientific things like physics and engineering. And pickles!
Ah yes, the oft-misunderstood science of pickles.
I'm Susie, and I'm fluent in every single language, even animal!
Now when you say every language, does that also include Klingon, Elvish, and Dothraki?
I'm Doofy, and I love to have as much fun as possible, all the time!
Why do you sound like a middle-aged woman with a cork shoved up her ass?
We're the Oogieloves!
Yes, make sure you pipe in that canned applause, otherwise the kids might not know what parts of the movie they're supposed to enjoy. And that's one of my main gripes with this movie. You know how the great children's entertainers like Fred Rogers, for example, were really good at talking to children at their level instead of talking down to them? This movie doesn't do that.
Virtually every aspect of this movie is dumbed down to the lowest common denominator, and you only need to watch a few minutes of it to see that. Assuming you can survive that long without, you know. The costume design looks like something that resulted from watching an episode of Teletubbies during a bad acid trip, and the mouths don't even move half the time. The songs are lazily thrown together, the Oogieloves singing is awful, and they make no effort whatsoever to make it look like they're actually playing those instruments. Hell, it looks like only one of Zeusie's keyboards is actually plugged in. I get the impression the people who made this film figured kids are stupid and we can sell them anything as long as we fill it with a lot of music and bright colors. Even if we assume that's true, that doesn't excuse their complete lack of effort. Your target audience should never be an indicator of quality. Whether you're aiming for 5-year-olds or 50-year-olds, do it well or don't do it at all. Anyway, the Oogieloves then proceed to explain this movie's gimmick. At various times during the movie, basically whenever a song begins or ends, you'll see either butterflies or turtles go across the bottom of the screen. If you see butterflies, stand up and start dancing like a monkey. If you see the turtles, sit down. That's right, they actually expected kids to dance and jump around in a movie theater. I have enough trouble sidestepping through a row to get to an empty seat without inadvertently shoving my ass or crotch in someone's face, so jumping and dancing are completely out of the question.
However, there probably wasn't a screening of this movie that had more than 10 people in attendance, which means there actually was plenty of room for dancing.
That's what you call ironic.
Oh, and even though they make it quite clear that butterflies mean stand up and turtles mean sit down, a concept so simple any child could understand it, they still feel the need to spell it out in text every time they show up on the screen, and the actors will often repeat the instructions as well. Like I said, no respect for the kids' intelligence.
This is the most amazing movie ever!
Let's not count that chicken before it hatches, okay?
So after that introduction is over, we're treated to a cheap-looking CGI intro with an equally cheap-looking transition to the town of Lovely Loveville. Yes, really, where the Oogieloves live. And it looks like they've already fallen asleep from boredom, which is not a good sign considering we're not 5 minutes into the movie. They're woken up by a song from Wendy, a disembodied face with a southern accent that resides in a window. Just one look and you can tell. There is no soul behind those eyes.
It's fun to see. When you wake up, a little tra-la-la, and a poodle-noodle-da, a rum-a-lam-a-loo, and a wonky-donky-doo.
Magic mirror on the wall. Who writes the dumbest lyrics of them all?
We're also introduced to the rest of the Oogieloves crew. Ruffy, a talking fish who can apparently survive without water, Schloofy, a sentient pillow that speaks in gibberish, and J. Edgar, a talking vacuum cleaner. Okay, I get that joke, but how many preschoolers are going to know who the hell J. Edgar Hoover is? In the rare moments when this movie isn't dumbing everything down, it's going way over the kids' heads. Oh, and the vacuum cleaner has a crush on the disembodied face in the window. Because that's not totally weird.
By now, you're probably wondering how in the hell the filmmakers created this cast of characters that is far too bizarre for words. Well, the answer is... they didn't.
These characters are actually based on a short-lived children's television show called My Bedbugs. A couple of names were changed, but otherwise the characters were basically the same. From what little information I've been able to gather, one of the show's themes was teaching children about cleaning up before bedtime, which would explain the vacuum cleaner and the pillow, though it doesn't explain why those characters are in the movie, which has nothing to do with cleaning up or bedtime. After My Bedbugs went off the air, it was likely destined to disappear into obscurity if it weren't for Ken Vissellman, the man who brought Teletubbies and Thomas the Tank Engine to the US. Apparently, he'd wanted to make a Teletubbies movie for some time, but the creator of the show wouldn't let him. So he bought the rights to My Bedbugs, applied a fresh coat of paint, reworked it into the Oogieloves, and made his own movie. And if you're wondering how he got the harebrained idea of creating an interactive movie, with dancing and jumping and all that, Vissellman claims it came from watching audience reactions during a screening of Tyler Perry's Medea Goes to Jail.
So the two franchises responsible for this mess are Teletubbies and Medea. Talk about putting a square peg in a round hole.
Getting back to the movie, today is Schloofy's birthday. Yeah, the pillow has a birthday, just go with it. And J. Edgar has acquired 5 magical balloons for a surprise birthday party. However...
I've lost Schloofy's balloons!
What did I say in my Bucky Larson review?
What the fuck am I watching?
That's right, what the fuck am I watching?
I have no earthly idea what just happened there. 1 minute he's rolling down the sidewalk and then he spontaneously spins around and goes crazy. Why?
Cocaine is a hell of a drug.
J. Edgar returns home with the bad news, and apparently he can't just go get more balloons because, for some reason, balloons are a very rare commodity in this universe, and they were the last 5 in town. But the Oogieloves tell him not to worry. J. Edgar can use Wendy's magical powers to find the balloons, and the Oogieloves will go get them and be back in time for the party. That's pretty much the entire plot of the movie. There's no real villain to speak of, it's basically just a fetch quest. Which would be fine for a half-hour kids' TV show. Unfortunately, this movie's runtime is just under 90 minutes and feels twice as long thanks to all the filler. And they waste no time getting to that filler. Before they can embark on their big balloon adventure, they have to change out of their pajamas. Thankfully, this doesn't take long.
Edison!
And then they have to eat breakfast, which of course involves a song and dance number. Don't get me wrong, I like pancakes as much as the next guy, but you don't hear me singing about it. When they're finally done with breakfast, the Oogieloves set out to find the first balloon, which is stuck at the top of a tree that houses a rather large teapot. The movie is not lacking in imagination, I'll give it that. Oh, and they bring the fish along because... reasons. When they arrive, they run into a girl with a stupid haircut, played by Kylie O'Brien.
Toofy? What a totally square name! I'm like Jubilee Rounder, and this is like totally where I live.
Jubilee, like last I checked, square is like totally not meant to be a compliment, okay? It's like totally an insult and stuff.
It's cool, I'm taking it back.
And since they have to get back home before Sloofy wakes up, you'd think they'd realize time is of the essence and they'd climb the tree and retrieve the balloon right away. Unfortunately, they're idiots, so they stop inside the teapot to meet Jubilee's grandmother, Dottie, played by... wait a minute...
is that... Cloris Leachman? That answers that question. Okay, throw it up.
And since Jubilee is, like, totally obsessed with squares and stuff, her grandmother Dottie is naturally obsessed with circles.
Won't you have a wonderfully rounded orange? Oh, will you bounce a giant rubber ball? Would you run around in circles? Oh, circles, circles. Oh, circles, how I love circles. Oh.
Okay, play it again.
Cocaine is a hell of a drug.
And it's time for yet another song, and Dottie invites the audience to sing and dance with her. And then proceeds to sit her ass down in the corner for about 80% of the song. And believe me, I totally understand if she's not physically capable of doing a full song and dance number. The woman is well past the age of 80 and probably on her second set of artificial hips at this point. I don't blame her. I blame the idiot filmmakers for putting someone in a dance number who is incapable of dancing. And as if that wasn't bad enough, the song ends on a fade out. And no, the movie doesn't fade to black or dissolve to the next scene or anything. The music fades out, the scene keeps going. I don't think I could be this lazy if I tried. After that nonsense is over, Toofy, who is apparently an expert climber, does what he should have done several minutes ago, climbs to the top of the tree, grabs the magical talking balloon with a creepy face because we didn't have enough nightmare fuel already, and floats back down to the ground. And his pants fall down.
Yeah, I forgot to mention this bit. Toofy's pants keep falling down. Comedy!
With that out of the way, it's time to move on to balloon number 2, which has landed on top of... oh, now that's just sad. There's an obvious gap between the sign and the diner. I refuse to believe this crappy Photoshop job cost $20 million. For this, I wouldn't pay $20.
Will you help me call out to Gooby?
Dude, it's a walkie-talkie. If you can't figure this out on your own, there's no hope for you.
We need to say these words twice.
Pretty sure we don't.
Testing, testing, wham, bam, pow. Gooby love, can you hear me now? Now you join in.
No, skip ahead.